and a very warm welcome back to Mavis on 4.
Good afternoon. It's very nice to be with you at the start of a new and busier series. For in a fortnight's time, I'll be here three times a week instead of two, on Mondays, Wednesdays and Fridays. Can you bear it? And can I? In the coming months, I'll be talking to many well-known people, but few will be quite as celebrated as the actress Bette Davis. Like many people, I reveled in her on the screen. She seemed to be the first actress to play real women, even when they were baddies and sometimes monsters. Could a woman ever be so poisonous as Regina in The Little Foxes, and so ghastly as the sister in Baby Jane, so inspiring as Miss Moffat in The Corn is Green, and so incredibly brave and moving, I cried buckets, in Dark Victory as she learns she's going blind. But what I wanted to know was what Bette Davis was really like behind all those masks. In fact, she was born Ruth Elizabeth Davis, the elder of two daughters. When she was seven, her father left. Eventually, she became the family's breadwinner. She married four times, had one child at 39, and adopted two others. Recently, she had a mastectomy, followed by a severe stroke. All this and more I've gleaned from this, her new book, This and That, which she was over here recently to publicize. And this gave me the wonderful chance to meet Bette Davis face to face. It is a real treat. I'm afraid I've even got a thumping heart at meeting you, Bette Davis. I hope you'll excuse a fan being here so near you.
Thank you.
I've been dipping into your book, dipping in and out, which is the kind of book you can do. You don't have to read it in one go. You can pick it up and put it down. And the thing that must have hit you very hard when you did have your operation and the stroke was just whether you were going to recover. I mean,
whether I was ever going to work again. Oh, yes. That was a permanent terror. Terror.
What did you get hit? I mean, a friend of mine recently had a bad operation and a stroke, and she went, depression hit her really so hard that she could not believe that life was going to be worth living. I mean, did it have that effect on you?
Not to that degree.
No.
But I was very fortunate. The girl who helped me write the book that I've dedicated this book to, Catherine Cermak, was with me all during the hospital and convalescence, and always said to me, we'll make it. And there's no question about it. That was the most fortunate thing. You need that terribly. Because, of course, you do have moments, especially when you're older. It's all this getting to walk again and do this and that again, dress yourself again. At this age, is it worth it? And every now and then I did feel that, no question.
But, I mean, you're saying, aren't you, though, that you were lucky to have someone that was willing to say to you, is worth it, come on, make it.
Right.
It's much harder, I suppose, if you are on your own, and often people are when
they're I think you just must have something like that, and I was the most fortunate of women that I had that.
I mean, was it that you could face? I mean, was it that you had to make an effort against feeling that you might as well die? Because that's another common and frequent feeling from a stroke, isn't it?
Yes, sometimes you want to.
Yes,
sometimes you want to. Sometimes you want to more than being upset whether you do or don't die. In my case, nobody thought I would ever work again or ever get well enough to work again. But there were a few people who believed I would. And Catherine Cermak was most certainly believed that. And it was a life, it saved my life. I know that.
Did you find yourself religious at that point, by the way? More so than before? Or are you religious?
Well, I have long chats with God, yes, and very, very difficult moments, and hope he will help me. And I had a lot of chats. but no more than usual. Mm. No, I did not become, well, very religious.
No.
Any more than I always have been. Basically believed there was something that helped us.
Would you call yourself a brave person?
I think up to a point I am, yes. Mm. I think I am brave about facing what I have to face.
Mm. So in other words, have you always been brave at facing death then, for instance?
Well, I've never thought about death
no.
very much.
Because no, you've been a healthy, fit person, yes.
Yes, I've never thought about
but
death.
But it must have come up very fast.
I only would be furious if I were dying, all the things I would miss.
Yes, I would be livid.
I would be livid to miss many things.
The other part in your book, which I hitched on to, was that when you said that you thought that you should beware, women should beware, of a man who never cries and a man who uses tears to get what he wants.
Right.
Never cries. When a man boasts he never cries is when I have
a
warning about it.
That is a big warning, boasts that he never cries.
Mm. But would you not say that the same is true of women, that you can't trust somebody who cries?
Oh, no,
to get
women use that for many, many,
many ways.
Mm. Yes, they use it in business, which makes it hard for those of us who don't to be trusted in business to behave in a professional way.
Mm. There's another bit that I wasn't so sure about, that I agreed with you about, which was that you say that you'd advise any woman against having an affair with a married man, believing he will ever leave his wife, no matter how often he says his wife doesn't understand him. You say that. But I mean, that can't be true, can it? That just can't be quite true, because there's so much divorce.
Yes, but I think a man who has an established marriage, Christmas, Thanksgiving, all the holidays, he will never leave home.
Mm.
I think that is average.
Do you also think, like you say in your book, that you think that if a woman is contented in love, in marriage, that she will not wander, but a man will always go out
always.
To howl at the moon, as you
Yes, that's right. Well, it's a central part of the male, no question. And I agree. A woman is very foolish to stray because she usually falls in love under those conditions. And I agree, if you are content, then you don't stray if you have a good marriage.
It's not putting men and women too sharply into divisions. I mean, there's a feminine streak in a lot of men and there's a masculine streak in a lot of women.
Right.
So it can't be entirely true, I wouldn't say, nowadays, would it, when men are beginning to say more about their feelings than they used to?
Yes, they are. And they're beginning to, if they both work, if the man and the woman both work, they're even beginning to kind of help in the kitchen maybe that
That's
evening.
Right.
That's a big revolution.
Yeah, indeed.
That was once considered so sissy, you would never, ever do a dish.
Mm.
So there's a lot along
that,
the way.
That must have also been a part of quite a difficult decision on your part to possibly have to give up domesticity, which you actually quite like.
Oh, I love, yes. I love. You mean to give it up for working?
Yeah.
Well, in all those years, there was a true dedication to make it.
Yeah.
And I just knew I couldn't do everything. Although I ran a house and sort of, you know, took care that it was taken care of. But of course could not do it myself at all.
Mm. But if you'd say you'd hadn't had your child at 39 but earlier, would you have possibly...
I think I definitely would have chosen the children.
Really?
I'm sure of it.
Yes.
And therefore, I had the best of two worlds. I was very, very fortunate. By the time I had my first child, the career was there.
Established.
So I had all the time to be with. Mm. And then with Beattie, and then we adopted two more children.
Mm.
So I was with them. It was a wonderful life.
Mm.
Exhausting life, children, however. I always felt when I went back to work between times, this was a holiday. It was so much easier than
to go to
with
work.
Children so much, yes, yes.
You've got to face up to yourself more with children than you do when you're at work, you know, is my theory.
Yes, of course you do.
Don't you think so? I mean,
there's a
much more critical thing going on between you and children.
Oh, yes,
than
because
you.
The responsibility is so enormous.
That's right.
To that child.
Yes.
Just enormous.
Mm. But When you found your career, right, taking off, probably more so just at the time when you had your baby, as a matter of fact, mustn't it have been? By the time when you were 40, say, was it that when your name was above the title?
Oh, long before that.
Long before
oh,
that.
No,
this so you were already a very established.
Oh, yes, very established. Mm. Very established star by 39, yes.
I was intrigued in your book also, This and That, that you said that you were definitely an Aries woman.
Yes.
What do you mean by that?
Well,
what is an Aries woman?
Well, an Aries woman is a perfectionist. Mm. She has to always be first. She's a worker. She's also considerate and not stubborn, like, say, a Taurus person, but very willful and is able, usually, to run her own ship. And that, those are all the handicaps. The perfectionist, that's a big handicap to you personally, because you spend your life doing things that don't necessarily have to be perfect. Like people have said to me, why are you worrying about your dinner you're cooking tonight? Why must it be perfect? I said, because I have to do everything that well. Mm. And it's a big, big inheritance.
It's a strain.
It's a big strain.
Isn't it? Because you
a
can
big
be
strain.
Good enough and pass,
yes,
can't you?
Yes, but that's, it doesn't work. No, it doesn't
I
work.
Think good enough is good enough for me, I must say. Can I tell you some of the things that I found out about Aries and see if it applies to you?
Right.
The Aries girl will open her own doors. She'll also put on her own coat, fight her own battles, pull out her own chair, hail her taxi, and light her cigarette without any masculine help.
Oh, yes, that is an Aries girl. Yes. Well, about the cigarettes, I smoke so many, I feel perfectly absurd sitting around like this and looking at a party to some man to come up and light my cigarette. Opening doors? Well, we don't have the great hoop skirts anymore, all that. And why should a man walk all the way around a car while you sit quite healthily and don't even start to open the door? Mm.
It looks so stupid.
They needed help out of carriages with their clothes once. But we don't. Mm. We don't. But there are many men, I've had many men in all my growing up that had been furious with me for this. And I always walked ahead when we were walking. Let's say you're walking down Fifth Avenue. I used to always work ahead if I was with somebody. And my first husband, Ham, I'm chatting away and streaking down Fifth Avenue, and I suddenly felt that he wasn't there. And he had stopped two blocks behind me to teach me a lesson that I had better walk with somebody. Yes.
Why did you walk ahead? Is it just because you were a strider? You're fast.
I just like to walk fast. Mm. I think that's the exercise of walking. Mm. Yes.
So, you agree with all that then so far?
Yes.
It says here too, she may think love is her whole existence, but she's too vitally absorbed in the world around her, not to mention in herself, for it to be the beginning and end of her life. She can get along without a man easier than any female you'll ever meet.
No.
Not true.
No.
I wouldn't think it's true of anybody, really.
It's not true of anybody. Mm. They're blaming all the women's lib women that they don't want men anymore. The stronger that you are, the more you need a man in your life. Mm. Absolutely need a man in your life. Fame, in my case, however, has been a very difficult enemy to a successful marriage. I mean, a man may feel when he proposes that this will not get in his way, but he does not like to be called Mr. Davis.
No, it's rude. But it's rude of the person calling him that, actually, by the way.
Yes, it is very rude.
Although we accept being called.
But no, that's just what happens. You cannot protect a man from this. Mm. Hard as you try, because I like being a wife, definitely. Mm. Mm.
I wonder why it went wrong then, just because of you being a threat to a man's ego, in that sense, that being more important than him. Women have had to be...
Plus, I'm a very exhausting human being. I'm very busy and very, very sort of with it. It's the way I am and like to live. And I think I was pretty exhausting from that standpoint, not only to men, but to other people I have known.
Demanding, would you say, then? Demanding?
No, I don't think I was too demanding, no. I'd like to get my own way, I have to admit. But no, I never felt I still don't feel I'm a demanding person. No.
Demanding of yourself, because you're a perfectionist.
We're demanding of myself.
But that can drip over into other relationships with other people.
Yes, that can.
Yeah. There's another bit about Aries woman, able to play the female role to the hilt with fluttering lashes and a well-timed tear, but just as able to take over a man's job when the men aren't around. Well, I've seen you fluttering your eyelids, lashes on the screen,
all
right.
On the screen.
You know how to do it there.
But... Well, if the character is that kind of a person.
Right, yeah.
But I'm not that kind of a person, yeah.
So we're not...
That's cheap. That's not right.
Yeah, so we're not getting on with the Aries characteristics completely then, are we?
No.
In this one. Aries women... An Aries woman has been really hurt. She turns from fire to ice. Her fire burns hot and dies quickly. Her ice can be eternal.
I've never been like that.
You're not?
No.
You forgive?
Yeah, I don't live in the past or mistakes and things. No, no.
Mm.
No, never like that.
I've got to find one that you think is right. She prefers the company of men to women.
Definitely.
Why?
Except I'm enjoying being with you.
Thank
Do
you
not
very
take
much.
That personally.
Indeed.
But I always have from a very young woman. I like men's minds better than the average woman's minds. I think, however, as you grow older, it is very important to have women friends as you grow older.
Yeah.
But when I was young, I liked men much better.
I think it's because we're on the hunt. We're out to find a man.
Oh, not I. So.
No?
Not I. No.
I think that's why
not
one
I.
gets, you know,
well,
looks for men.
Well, it could be. Could be. Right.
But if you say that, you know, you prefer men's minds to women, it was ironical that, in a sense, because of your father leaving home, you had to be the so-called man of the family, wasn't
but
it?
But you see, I knew my father. Even at that young age, I knew my father made my mother miserable. And I was so glad that he went, for her sake.
Mm. But then you had to take on the role.
Well, that was many years later, of course.
Of course it was.
Well, of course, when my father said... He was still alive. My father said, "You make more money than I do. You may have the family." I was so proud that I could take care of my family.
Which is your mother and your...
My mother and my sister. But that was just a... Well, my mother, of course, I never, ever was sorry to do anything for I could.
What kind of woman?
Well, she worked at every kind of job in the world to give me good schools. Yes, my father was a lawyer, so of course the alimony was very, very little. He arranged that. But my mother, she just was a terrific help. Not as a stage mother, but as earning enough money so I could go to a dramatic school, I could do this, I could do that. Everything to help me.
What did she want from her life? I mean, was she one person that wanted to be a loving mother? I mean, or did
she
have ambitions? Yes, but did she have ambitions for herself or not? Did she work? Did she?
Oh, my dear, she studied and became a professional photographer. Very, very fine.
Yes.
Very fine work. Oh, yes. Definitely.
Do you ever feel that you that role imposed on you, though, changed your attitude to your own life? I mean, perhaps delaying things in your life, in your domestic life, when you're responsible for a family. So,
I guess I never sort of felt that way.
No.
I never did feel that way.
I wonder how things would have changed if your father hadn't left when you were 7. Do you think it would have changed very much?
Hadn't.
Yes, if you hadn't gone.
I think I would never have gone into the theater because I think he would never have allowed it.
Really?
Oh, yes.
Well, that would have been a
huge loss. He thought it was so silly.
Right?
Yes, he thought I should become a secretary very soon so I would make money very soon. No, he would never have... he was proud with his friends behind my back, but to my face, paid no attention to it.
Were you hurt by that experience, do you think?
No, but I did not like him.
You didn't?
No, I didn't like the way he treated my mother.
Yeah.
I didn't like him.
Mm. So for you, it was better that he was away rather than there.
Well, I think as the career is concerned, I think that was very fortunate for me.
Mm.
Very.
Since you brought up the word career, shall we have a look at your most recent bit of your career, which is an extract from your film? Yes? It's a real treat now for Bette Davis fans, a glimpse of her latest film, due for release in America this month, and it's called The Whales of August. It's set on an island where two old ladies have spent their summers for the last 60 years. Bette Davis plays one sister who is blind, and Lillian Gish the other. And Vincent Price is a thoroughly sinister Russian whom they're entertaining in this clip.
And then, in the winter, when we come back to St. Petersburg, it was my uncle, the Grand Duke, who gave the most elegant entertainments. And the ladies waltzing, da-da-da-da-da-dum, dum-da-da-da-da. Their gowns seemed to rise and fall, but never to touch the floor.
Oh, I'm so glad you came. How often does one get a chance to entertain a member of the Russian imperial court?
These days, my dear, almost never.
You mustn't be so modest, Mr. Marinoff.
Once a nobleman, always a nobleman.
Alas, dear ladies, all of this is in the past.
Tisha has told us about your photographs.
Oh, forgive me, Mrs. Strong. My mother... at the Winter Palace, 1910, I believe.
Photographs fade. Memories live forever.
Alas, Mrs. Strong, memories can fade too.
That has not been my experience.
So are you strong on memories then? Have you got a very clear memory of the past, Betty?
Yes.
Mm.
Yes.
You can recall it as you want to.
Yes, I can really remember. Mm.
I think it's good company having a good memory.
Yes, sometimes.
And sometimes it's a horrible
experience, right?
That's right.
Right.
So what do you do to get rid of horrible ones in your mind?
In my mind? Oh, well, I don't really know. I suppose I just, every now and then, will think of the same thing.
Mm.
Or not. Depends.
Mm. There's another one about Aries. Let's check again, shall we? To injure her pride or dampen her enthusiasm will almost break her heart.
Well, I've been fortunate. I don't think anybody sort of has done that to me.
Hmm.
Been fortunate.
What, that they've never tried to dampen your enthusiasm, for instance?
Oh, I suppose many people must have, because my enthusiasm is... enormous for whatever I'm enthusiastic about. Yes, I suppose if they're not enthusiastic about the same thing, I suppose it's exhausting.
Mm.
Yes.
There's a sweet little one, I think, that it says that an April mother will take her children for walks in the park and point out the sparkling necklaces left on the lawn by the fairies when they dance under the moon where others might see only the early morning dew on the grass. Aries women create a magic world of fantasy for their children.
No, I've always believed in creating a good real world for my children.
Mm.
I mean, we all have, you know, things we imagine and all, but basically I never agreed totally with too much fantasizing.
Mm.
I think it can be harmful.
I think fantasy is wrong when it's a description of something beautiful. I mean, I think the book's wrong to say that is fantasy. As to point out to
people
what you like about life. I think you must have been good at that.
Well, you know, the word fantasy is the dreams of my world all these years.
Quite.
Terrific dreams. Well, that's important that people have dreams. And they've replaced dreams with fantasies. And they're not the same thing at all.
Thank you very much for sparing your time with me today.
Well, I have loved spending my time with you today.
Thank you. I did enjoy meeting Bette Davis. I hope you did. This and That is published by Sidgwick & Jackson at £12.95. And the other book I was using, by the way, was Linda Goodman's Star Signs. On Wednesday, by contrast, I'll be talking to a woman who is at the beginning of her career. She's Irish blues singer Mary Coughlan, who has been described as a red-haired warrior queen with a voice like bleeding cherries. We'll be hearing that voice on Wednesday. Join me then. Goodbye for now.